We've been discussing telescopes. So chapter 6 of the book introduces the idea of telescopes. Telescopes are the tools that gather the light. Once you gather the light, though, you need to do something with it. And so there's several things you can do. You can use an eyepiece, look in the telescope and see things. Use your eyes to actually analyze the light. That's good and bad. It's good because you're directly measuring things and you're seeing things. On the other hand, your eyes are limited. You only see a narrow part of the electromagnetic spectrum, and your eyes are limited in the dimmest they can see and the brightest they can see. And so when you're looking at things in the telescope, you are limited to how dim you can see. And so this is where it's possible to use other instruments attached to the telescope to even enhance even better than just using the telescope. One of the first things you do is replace the eyepiece. Now, it's really cool to have an eyepiece looking at a telescope, but professional astronomers don't generally use eyepieces. Most professional telescopes don't even have eyepieces. Instead, there's a camera. Well, why? Well, a camera gives you an objective view. When you look with your own eye, you record what you see. Your eye sees only a very narrow part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So you're missing a lot of stuff. Your eye can only see something so dim. Cameras have an interesting property, and that is a time exposure. The longer the camera looks at something, the more light gathers in and the dimmer it can see. Your eye doesn't work that way. You can't just sit there and stare at something and watch it get brighter as you're looking. That's not how your eye works. That is how cameras can work. And so that is something that was readily apparent in the early days of photography. So in the 1800s, when cameras got good enough, they could start taking photographs, then cameras became a major tool for astronomy. Now, the early cameras used chemicals that, when the light hit the chemical, caused a chemical reaction, which you developed it and it fixed it. And so now you have a permanent record. So that's how you got pictures. The original cameras used glass plates with chemicals on them that, eventually evolved into plastic film with chemicals on there. So you have film cameras. A lot of amateur astrophotographers got started with film cameras. The problem with film cameras, though, is the film has its own limitations. So an interesting thing happened at Texas Instruments in Dallas. An engineer was studying the semiconductors that, when light hits the semiconductor, it produces electric charge. And so you end up with electric charge here, and the electric charge is in certain spots on the chip. And so what would happen is you could use a computer to read off that chip, and because each pixel corresponded to a certain amount of light, you have a digital picture. Now that's how all digital cameras work today. It's called a charge couple device. It was originally designed as an optical storage unit instead of magnetic storage, but then other engineers said, hey, wait, you could actually just take a picture with that. And so the early CCDs weren't all that great, but then they got better and better. So here's an example. For example, in your book, there's a picture of what a film camera would do. And film was so much better than your eye. With the same telescope, the same time exposure, then you get that. Okay, now that's digital, so you can process it. Use the computer to clean it up, and you get this picture right there. Now, to clean it up, you need very little electrical noise. So most astronomical CCDs tend to be a little bit bigger and bulkier than your generic camera, though modern SLR cameras are so good that a lot of amateur astronomers are using them. They're starting to gradually replace astronomical CCDs for amateurs. Professionals still need a specialized instrument that's usually cooled to liquid nitrogen temperatures because that minimizes electronic noise. Electronic noise puts extra dots in the image, and of course, a dot looks like a star. And so you want to cool these things, and so your astronomical camera doesn't really look a whole lot like what you normally think of as a camera. Besides cameras, we also know about active optics. We've already talked about that with our telescopes, the idea of segmented mirrors. And the big telescopes would get out of focus if you're not careful. And so what you do is you build a segmented mirror, and then you need to focus this. And so they would often shoot a beam, a laser beam, into the mesosphere, upper part of the atmosphere, and then they would point the telescope at that and image on that beam and bring everything into focus, and that's how you do active optics. At McDonald Observatory, the Hubble-Eberly telescope, this right here is the laser tower that shoots upwards. So question, why is the back end of it painted black? Well, because the telescope is right here, and they don't want any possible reflected reflected light into there, whether it be moonlight or starlight or headlights of cars off in the distance or whatever. So that's why that's painted kind of a flat black right. The other thing here is adaptive optics. Your book talks about adaptive optics, and what I've done here is I've actually added to what your book says about adaptive optics a little bit. Because this is a very interesting sort of tool right here. And the idea of adaptive optics is that light passing through the atmosphere is distorted. A lot of amateur astronomers try to buy really big telescopes because they think the really big telescope is going to get a better view. But if your telescope is more than 12 to 15 inches across, then turbulence in the atmosphere causes the incoming light, instead of coming in uniform wave fronts, to be kind of wiggly. That means parts in focus, parts out of focus. And so that limits, you know, how big of a telescope you can have and still have it be really getting the sharper image. Well, one way around that is you have the light coming in and it hits a bank of mirrors here that can adjust several hundred times a second. The light bounces off the mirrors and then it hits a beam splitter. Half the light keeps going to a camera and half the light goes to a set of detectors that detects fluctuations in there. When it detects a fluctuation, it sends a signal back to that part of the mirror to adjust it. And so that means that what goes to the camera is corrected and focused. And so an example of this is an adaptive optics image of the planet Neptune. So on the left, we have Neptune as one of the best views from Earth in a telescope. Well, you have distortion in there because of the Earth's atmosphere. On the right, adaptive optics removes some of that distortion, and you get a view of Neptune that's almost as good as the Hubble Space Telescope, eliminating some of the problems with atmospheric distortion. Likewise, you look in the center of the galaxy. This is an infrared telescope right here, so it's able to see through some of the stuff between us and the center of the galaxy. And the light of the stars all blurs together, and you just get a big blur. But with adaptive optics on, you can see the individual stars near the center of the galaxy. So these are the tools that we're using in astronomy. In addition to just a telescope, you have to also attach the telescope to something that analyzes the light. Well, the other thing that you can do is you want to measure how bright things are. So it's not just images. A photometer doesn't even take a picture. And I've actually published several papers using a device that looks almost exactly like that. And this is a photometer that's connected to a telescope. You point the telescope at a star and that measures the precise magnitude of the star and you measure very small variations of that magnitude. That was my research that I did in graduate school, was eclipsing binary stars or a type of variable star. So that measures magnitudes of stars. The other thing that you can do is you can take light, collimate it through a little slit, bounce it off of something called diffraction grating, which splits the light into all its individual colors, and you can see the spectrum of a star. And so if you you look at the spectrum of a star, for example, then you get a black body spectrum that looks like that. We talked about black body spectrum with light. And so we get this black body spectrum, and these little dips in that black body spectrum turn out to be spectral lines due to certain gases. And so you can then match that up in the laboratory. You can use an emission tube and find out which colors of light are given off by a particular kind of gas, match those to the spectral lines you see in a star, and now you have the ability to measure the chemical composition of a star. You need a spectrometer or spectrograph, which are related type of instruments here, that make these kind of measurements. And so most telescopes, the images are cool. That's what they publish for the public. But astronomers are really much more excited by tables of numbers that you get out of a photometer, or a whole bunch of squiggly lines that you get out of a spectrograph. Because now that's telling you a lot more information than just the pretty pictures do. And so this is using instruments. So not just telescopes, but instruments attached to the telescope. The bigger the telescope, the bigger and heavier and more detailed instrument you can put on the telescope. And so this is another reason for wanting a big telescope, is you get a big enough telescope and it can handle a 500-pound instrument connected to it. So that's kind of the advantage of this sort of thing. Again, coup de focus telescopes, you can have a 2 or 3 ton instrument that doesn't move. And so here we have an idea of using telescopes with instruments. Now, our next set of topics, though, goes one step further, and that is looking outside of the visual spectrum. So that'll be our next topic of study, are telescopes that are non-visual telescopes.